Welcome to Positive Atheism English Channel. From the book The Life and Times of Gora, written by Mark Lindley, today, in continuation of the 8th chapter, Gora's Political Activism in the 1950s and 60s, we shall know about the remaining part. In 1954, the Socialist Party of India, which JP had founded in 1948, organized in Andhra a land reform effort in a village where the surrounding fields were owned by absentee Brahmin landlords who got between a quarter and a half of the produce. The tillers, whose ancestors had tilled the same land for a long time, demanded title to it. The landlords tried to bring in scabs from other villages. The traditional tillers obstructed their arrival and occupied the land non-violently. At this point, Gora sent Saraswati to organize the women of the community to join in the effort. This strengthened the resistance and won the attention of the provincial government, which legislated in favor of the tillers whose parents, grandparents, etc. had worked the same land. They won title to it in 1955. Meanwhile, the Bhudan movement had become renowned throughout India because JP had joined it and because Vinoba declared in 1954 that the centenary of the 1857 mutiny against the British was to be the year of a land revolution, which would somehow be the climax of the movement, but which it did not define more precisely. This was such an inspiring message that by 1956, some 10,000 activists, including Gora, had joined the effort. Gora expected that Vinoba would call for non-violent protests in 1957 to express the peasants' demands for land reform and other progressive measures, but that same prospect frightened many landowners and Congress Party politicians. Nehru conferred with Vinoba in 1957, and the result was an arrangement whereby Nehru directed the government bureaucracy to collaborate with Bhutan volunteers in rebuilding villages regardless of whether additional land donations were made or not made, and Vinoba, for his part, refrained from calling for any protests against landowners or the government. Some of the young Bhutan volunteers who had expected more of Vinoba looked now to Gora to provide a more militant kind of leadership. Part of his response was a radiantly hopeful book published initially in English 1958 and soon in Hindi translation as well, entitled Vai Gram Raj. Gram Raj means village self-rule. The book drew upon an analogy between an extended Indian family and a village holding its property in common. Sacrifice and sympathy are not together a new tendency in human affairs, but in the course of civilization, such a tendency remained confined mostly to the narrow limits of families, whereas greed and selfishness have been the dominant factors in relationship with neighbors. Everyone practices the two methods at once because he is a member of a family as well as the neighbor of others. The essential difference between the family method and the other lies in the nature of property relations. In the case of a family, the property is owned in common by all the relatives. They improve the family property by joint effort and share and enjoy its fruits. A complementary argument was that the system of private property incites its votaries to exploit others by hook or crook. Gora admitted that greed, callousness, and cruelty sometimes filter into families and disturb their harmony. But he believed that for the most part, the antisocial tendencies of fraud, greed, and violence are associated with the method of competition and cannot be avoided unless private property is abolished and an alternative security is established in the form of common ownership of property. He said, "The family, on account of its smallness, affords good freedom, but the very smallness renders it incapable of economic self-sufficiency. Socialist dictatorship, on the other hand, is large enough to afford food for all, but on account of its largeness, it becomes dictatorial and curtails the freedom of the individual. Gram Raj strikes the golden mean." He criticized as follows Gandhi's concept of trusteeship. "No one need to be a caretaker of fellow men lest, as experience has shown, the greed in him would turn him into an exploiter or a dictator that he was not before." He said the welfare state is akin to trusteeship and requires such heavy taxation as would make it virtually a dictatorship. As it attempts to mitigate the evils of private property and to maintain a harmonious balance between the rich and poor. He took a dim view of political parties. Like the priest between the innocent believer and his incomprehensible God, the political party functions as a middleman between the common citizen and his power-ridden government, Seldom does a middleman rise above the profit motive, especially when middlemanship is a profession. His views in regard to machines and work and leisure were mostly the same as Kumarappa's. He said, leisure and work become distasteful if one is diverse from the other. Work is best enjoyed when it is done leisurely. So instead of hurrying with a mission, working leisurely is an alternative which Gramraj adopts. He admitted that certain kinds of missions are useful aids to civilization and are not only indispensable but should be improved and widely employed too. But even so, he suggested that villages which have to utilize their manpower as well as their material resources should not encumber themselves with needless machinery. Mission is the servant of man, and man must use it as a servant. It should not be allowed to create either unemployment or unnecessary leisure. In a three-page section on Satyagraha at the end of a revised edition of the book 1960, he suggested that it be used in programs of reading a government of political parties, of reducing pomp of people's representatives. Party and pomp are creating a wide gulf between the people and their representatives who hold power. When the distance is reduced, the representatives can be kept under the control of the people. In addition to making use of this book in dozens of study camps throughout most of India, he led a series of marches and satyagrahas in South India in the name of Ardhik Samata Mandal and in North India in the more vigorous sounding name of a new Satyagraha Samaj. Would political parties ever achieve land reform? The most powerful one was the Congress, many of whose local leaders were landlords. Where it had a decisive majority, it might choose not to do anything. Where its majority was frail, the opposition parties might prevent it from doing anything effective. In the end, what happened was that ostensible land reform laws were passed by various provincial legislatures but were actually implemented only in the two provinces, West Bengal and Kerala, where the communists governed. In those provinces, the achievement was made only after a lot of strife. It was in hopes of mitigating the strife in Kerala that Gora spent several weeks there in 1958-59. A communist-led front in Kerala, developed by the CPA after pondering their losses in the 1955 elections in Andhra, had won a legislative majority in the 1957 provincial elections and had begun not only to implement land reform but also to regulate the private schools owned and operated by powerful religious organizations, the Roman Catholic Church, the Muslim League, and some analogous Hindu institutions. The Congress in Kerala made tactical political alliances with those religious organizations to oppose the reforms. In January 1959, Indira Gandhi became president of the Indian National Congress. In April, she visited Kerala, approved of these alliances, and criticized vigorously the elected communist government, accusing it of taking its orders from China. The communists reacted by using illegal and sometimes violent means to liquidate the Congress party at the local level. In June, Indira told a newspaper correspondent, "As Congress president, I intend to fight the communists and throw them out." And her father visited the capital of Kerala, Trivandrum, and was shocked by the atmosphere thereof near hysteria with thick walls of group hatred. He asked the chief minister to call fresh elections immediately, that is, without serving the 5-year maximum allowed after his victory in 1957. But the chief minister refused. In July, Nehru had president's rule invoked to replace the elected provincial government with temporary rule by a governor appointed from New Delhi. Since Indira had suggested to Nehru that he do it, some historians regard this fact as is the first strong evidence of a tendency in her, which has to become clear in later years, to react with authoritarian measures when stirred by fear of political instability. It was during this crisis that Gora went to Kerala and toured the whole province in the name of Ardhik Samata Mandal and with the support of the local Gandhian organizations, calling for partyless democracy and leading marches with two flagpoles. All the party flags were on one pole, while the other one, with no flag on it, symbolized citizens who had no party affiliation. The idea was that the local village councils could work without political parties. Thank you. We'll meet in the next episode again.
Please download Samaram Multichannel app and watch your favorite channels from your mobile. App available on Google Play Store and subscribe to the channels. For more videos, please subscribe to this channel, Positive Atheism, and activate the bell icon.